In 300 feet, turn right. Take the next left.
At a protest outside a hostel housing asylum seekers, hundreds of people have been charged in connection with violent unrest across England and Northern Ireland in recent weeks. That's the latest BBC News.
In 1,000 feet, turn left onto Pine Swamp Road T337.
Thank you.
In a quarter mile, turn left onto Elementary Drive.
He told us that each vehicle was hosed up, flushing the mud of the car from around the wheels. The muddy water was then treated with chemicals to disinfect it and kept in storage for a year so it could be monitored for the presence of fungus.
Turn left onto Elementary Drive, then turn left onto Stadium Drive.
He has seen firsthand the devastation caused by the fungus.
I was working in Latihera when a fusarium came. All of us lost our jobs. I was about to work in a banana plantation, but then I felt the call to work here because I didn't want the fungus to arrive here, and I saw the damage it did. No one wants the fungus to arrive here. I'm doing all I can so it never comes.
That fear of the fungus is echoed by banana growers like Alfonso Castillo.
Here in the war, in Colombia, so when the fusarium came to Colombia, it first arrived in the Cartagena region. It was really scary because I have a small company and I get by what I have. I give my kids a good quality of life and education with the little I get from my work.
So in a quarter mile, turn left onto Orchard Drive.
The fear is really, really big, so it's really scary. The challenge of thinking what I'm going to do is too much. I can live with other banana viruses, but I can't live with fusarium virus. What we've got to do now is try to delay it.
Take the next left onto Orchard Drive.
It's been in our lives. It's difficult to imagine what we'd do if we couldn't grow bananas in the way we're growing.
Carry on, I understand there are some actual abandoned villages because they've been so badly affected. What are they like?
In a quarter mile, turn left onto Lawrence Drive.
Towns, because the people that used to live there, they left the towns because now the banana plantation's not there. They had to get some other jobs, some at all the banana plantations.
Okay, but all the facilities, are the shops closed? Is there anything going on?
Take the next left onto Lawrence Drive.
Closed, yes. When I visited one of those ghost towns, I met in the Viennese members.
Continue on Lawrence Drive for 1 mile.
My main source of work is banana factories. It's hard to find another job. When the banana producers arrived, lots of people came from outside. People moved here and the village grew incredibly. There were three or four families squeezed into some of the houses. The shops and the businesses made twice the usual amount. And even the school was hugely oversubscribed. But then we had the problem with the bananas and the disease arrived. Now, only five houses on the street are inhabited. The devastation of communities has led to a desperate plea. Here's Elena Bonicelli from the Banana Producers Association, Agura. Confío en que la ciencia nos ayude a avanzar. I trust that the science will come and help us. In these difficult times, the banana producers will follow all the biosecurity protocols to try to buy us time. Either the researchers can then carry on their work and eventually develop...
In a quarter mile, turn left onto Apple Drive.
Or we find a way to coexist with the disease. But as we have seen from other countries, and especially in Asia, it is impossible to live with this catastrophic disease. So, realistically, there's no alternative. We just need to buy time, and we believe that the science will come and help us.
Confiamos en que la ciencia nos ayude.
Take the next left onto Apple Drive.
Is science will find a way to defeat tier 4.
Eliana, thank you very much indeed. There are many techniques being tried to stop the spread of the fungus. If you prefer a more natural method, then in China, they've noticed that planting a specific type of leek around banana plants can halt the disease. In the Netherlands, they're crossbreeding strains of the Cavendish in the hope of finding a more resistant variety. While in Australia, scientists have developed a genetically modified Cavendish banana that could be resistant to TR4, but releasing genetically modified crops for human consumption still remains controversial in many countries. And then there is Austria, where nuclear science is being deployed. There they hope to create a disease-resistant strain of the... by blasting it with radiation. It's a tried and tested technique called mutagenesis, and I just had to take a look.
In a quarter mile, continue straight onto Pennsylvania 42 North, Pennsylvania 487 North.
I can even see snow on the hills in the distance, and I'm on a kind of light industrial estate. It in fact is some of the buildings of the International Atomic Energy Agency, and I can see their slogan ahead of me walking down long corridors with lots of warning signs, including that kind of very alarming kind of nuclear X-ray warning sign. Danger.
I'm Pooja Bhatnagar Mathur. I'm the laboratory head for plant breeding and genetics laboratory of the joint FAO-IAA center here in Cybersurf, Lower Austria.
Well, this is very satisfying laboratory. There's men in white coats, literally men in white coats. There's lots of beakers. And then we just come into a room, and there's these trays that are moving, being sort of gently shuffled on a mechanical device. I can see, I'm guessing something like 100 different little beakers, all with tin foil on the top, and they've got plants inside. Pooja, what are the plants?
And what you see here in these flowers are banana plantlets growing in liquid media. These cultures are irradiated using nuclear-based mutagenesis methods, like in this case we use either X-rays or gamma rays in low dosage, since these are very fragile plants. We are just trying to accelerate the process of mutagenesis, which is otherwise a natural process, and picking out the ones that shows us resistance to pests that you have. This is our pathology lab, and this is where we kind of keep our cultures, we grow our cultures, the pathogen culture, for evaluating our mutants that we generate. In this instance, it's banana. This is an inoculation for TR4 that we are preparing.
It's just kind of amazing to see that is the fungus that is causing all the problems, and it's located in a little beaker in front of me. Right, let's close the incubator. I've been brought into what's called the irradiator room, which is sparklingly sterile, and I've had to put on what's called a dosimeter to check that I'm not going to get dangerous levels of radiation, and there's a little monitor here. So what happens in this room?
So we irradiate this in vitro plant in small tubes.
What has nuclear science got to do with plant breeding?
What we are doing here is we are subjecting the biological material, the crops, the seeds, the in vitro plants that you saw in the lab, subjecting them to this irradiation. We are able to provide the desired dosage to these plant cells for their DNA to break and make the DNA system of the plant to work on its own and create those mutations that we are looking for.
Sorry to sound unscientific here, but you are sapping the plants with X-rays and memories. It's as simple as that.
Yes, you can say that in a simpler, more simple version, yes.
This route avoids a road closure on River Drive. You are on the best route. You should reach your destination by 6:01 p.m.
It was first developed in the 1920s when experiments were conducted on fruit flies using X-rays. Today, the International Atomic Energy Agency is training up scientists from countries affected by the fungus to help them develop their own disease-resistant varieties. So for people who might be slightly wary about the idea that plants' DNA is being altered by radiation, if you're in a supermarket, what might you end up buying actually comes
not new, as
right lane to take the US 11 North, Pennsylvania 42 North Ramp to I-80, Bloomsburg.
So a banana party have been given a dosage of gamma rays, and we're now going to go to a greenhouse to see how the banana plants.
Use the right lane to take the US 11 North Ramp.
To this radiation. I'm outside what the IEA call their tropical dome where they grow coffee.
In a quarter mile, take the Pennsylvania 42 North exit toward I-80, Knoebels.
See the Alps with snow on, so it seems slightly weird that we could get tropical plants, but let's have a look.
Pennsylvania 42 North exit.
Into a tropical greenhouse, and my glasses have steamed up terribly.
Continue for 2 miles.
All of humid heat and lots of very verdant young plants. Are these bananas?
Yes, these are bananas. Yeah, we are working with banana. You know that banana is one of the most important crop in the world, and 400 million people and 135 countries are producing banana.
Now, inside that sweltering greenhouse, I discovered fully grown versions of the plant tissue that had been zapped. The story of the Cavendish has echoes of an earlier variety called the Gromy Shell, or the Big Mike. At the end of the 19th century, it was the dominant banana around the world, when it started to be suddenly wiped out by the TR1 fungus. Back then, the now-threatened Cavendish strain took over because it was resistant to that fungus. Could history be about to repeat itself? Anyway, back to the greenhouse. My guide was plant breeder and geneticist Fatma Sasu. These banana plants, they ain't, you know, just plastic pots I might find in my own garden. These banana plants are going to be sent out to maybe Colombia to be tested to see if they are resistant.
Yes, we have some projects. We are working with the many member states, including Colombia as well. China has already developed tropical race for resistant variety. Name is Junjayu. Junjayu number 4. Now we are trying to expand the success with the other countries, including Colombia, Mozambique, and Brazil.
Is Junjayu number 4 a Cavendish banana?
Yes, this is a Cavendish banana.
Okay, so why aren't I eating the Junjayu number 4 Cavendish banana when I go into a supermarket?
This is Chinese variety. If you go to China, you can eat this.
But it's not being exported.
That is country's decision, you know, with bilateral agreements. Through that agreement, any country can reach out to China to have this access to this variety.
But there are some people who worry that, for instance, my children, who have grown up with bananas, their children will never know. The banana could be wiped out. I'm just wondering how hopeful or worried you are about the future of the banana.
I have the same question. Do you imagine a world without banana?
Yeah, obviously very, very common in Africa. And these
22 miles.
That is, I have seen it special screen presses, but again, they're just not exporting in any commercial quantities.
They're meant to be softer, sweeter than Cavendish, with a slightly tangy raspberry flavour. I found in East Africa, Asia, and South America, red velvet. Again, a trial to get into.
Yeah, red velvet. I hate to make a run obvious here, but it's soft and unlike the little dinky small one. It's basically the size of a big thumb. This is smaller than a standard knife, but it is red. It's kind of russet, russet, rusty red. Let's have a try.
Disorder at a protest outside a hotel housing asylum seekers.
The teenager punched and kicked the building's entrance during the recent wave of anti-immigration protests. BBC News.
Welcome to the documentary In the Studio from the BBC World Service. In this week's program, Monk on the Move, we unpack how an art exhibition travels to three countries.
Is a courier from the Monk Museum.
from the content, the kids are a different kind of world, different states.
In order to install the exhibition at the Babalini, the museum is closed for visitors, so it's very quiet in the house when we return on Monday and make an interesting discovery. The entrance, where visitors usually just wander into the exhibition halls without a further thought, is now blocked by a heavy steel door. Only very few people are allowed in. So we're very lucky that they let us in too to see what happens behind that door. It's a large space with sumptuous dark green walls. been stolen here in Potsdam. The paintings concerned.
In 2 miles, take exit 210A from US 15 south toward Lewisburg.
As a courier.
We're driving on two talk farm courier trips because we don't want people to know when our paintings are moving and where they're going. It's okay when it's on the wall, then people know it's an exhibition, but we don't talk about the trips.
But before she actually gets to travel with a painting,
we have a loans committee. Usually if people want to loan art from us, they have to apply to this committee at least sort of 6 or 9 months ahead. And then the security and registrars and art historians and conservators come together and they judge if the loan is important, if it's a good exhibition it's going to, if the artwork is not a condition to travel. And then often it gets really hectic around all these rotating seasons because everybody changes exhibition at the same time. So then we have to be enough people to make sure that we can be in Massachusetts and Berlin and Oslo and Stockholm and Copenhagen at the same time.
Each room in the exhibition has a theme, and we are in the section called Snow and Storm, where the painting White Night is going to be hung.
It was shown in America, so this last year it's been traveling twice with me. It's one of his very atmospheric paintings.
In a half mile, take exit 210A for US 15 south toward Lewisburg. At 210A, then merge onto US 15 South.
The painting is now placed against the wall to determine its exact spot for hanging.
The wall color is like a little green, sort of bluish green, very close to the emerald green.
With the painting almost in place, is Edith's current...
Continue on US 15 south for 7 miles.
It's really up to the wall, and I have to photograph everything and report back to the security force.
You're listening to the documentary In the Studio from the BBC World Service. I'm Susan Stone at the Museum Babamini in Germany to find out what it takes to mount the traveling exhibition Edgar Munch, Trembling Earth. It's a few days later, and there's a different buzz in the air. The paintings are hung, and the team moves on to installing the works that Munch created on paper.
It's a new situation for us today.
Today we have graphic works.
We had a change of plan.
And the paper conservators got hired, so we have to step in for her.
And other painting conservators that are working with us, they have.
Installing the works on
when you see these works packed up, what's it like to see them unpacked?
A relief, usually, that everything has arrived safely. That's our biggest concern, but it's also fun to see how the paintings come to life. They're placed against a different wall color in a different space, but it's also like seeing a friend again. You're still in a caretaking relationship with the paintings. It's hard to believe it's the end of this project because it's been 2.5 years of seeing the paintings, seeing them on the computer, checklists, and then to see them come to life and now to be saying farewell for now.
As Angela gets ready to say goodbye to Long's art, we rejoin Matthias back in the room, snow and storm. We had the chance to listen in a little bit on the curator talking about where they're going to place some of the works and what they're all things about, so that is a bit of change going on today.
I can say it's not the only wall that has been changed entirely for today, because we are standing in another room and here the plan of this corner of the room has changed completely, and this is the proof that as a curator one always in the end has to stand in front of the original. If you only have the images in your computer and you click around with them and you arrange your walls virtually, it's a nice support, but it's never like, what is the frame, what is the color, and so on. And we had the same situation today, that we have completely changed the schedule concerning an American loan for a private collection and another loan that is going to be installed this afternoon. The only thing is, and our curators know this, and every curator knows that, as soon as the courier has left, we are not allowed to touch the artworks anymore. So, when the courier leaves, decisions must be final.
What's curator Jill Lloyd's take on that last minute change?
It's in the room about snow and storm, and we have a very important room called a storm painting, and we wanted to really highlight that, but at the same time we wanted a very strong image for the exit to the room. And the last painting that we'd done digitally simply wasn't strong enough when it arrived. It's a good painting, but it's not of the strength of some of the other works in the room. So we just changed things around, and now we have, I think, a very beautiful painting, the snow-covered forest, as the last work in the room, and the MoMA painting is on its individual wall.
And yet you do have a little bit of pressure, because there comes a point at which you cannot change the order of paintings for MoMA.
Yes, absolutely. The careers, they have to be present when the work is on the wall, and once it's in place, you can't move it.
One of the paintings that many people know best from MoMA is the screen. We do have the screen here, but it's not a painting.
No, it is actually impossible to borrow the painted versions. Now, they're fragile. They're also such a central feature of the Oslo museums that they can't lend them. So we knew from the beginning that in all likelihood we won't be able to show the print.
Which picture has been particularly hard to get?
Well, it was hard to get even a print version of the screen. And I did run through quite a few private collectors before the private collector who has lent kindly agreed to lend. The screen is always extremely difficult. At one point I thought I could borrow it from a Norwegian private collector and loan. That particular version went to Paris, so we brought it here. You've got to be very careful with the works on paper because they have to be very light controlled. If they've travelled to one place, they shouldn't travel immediately afterwards. They should rest for several months.
What's left on your checklist?
Well, today I want to go through and read the English texts that I haven't read. I did notice the English wall texts have arrived now.
Since you mentioned wall texts, is that something that you're very involved with?
I was very involved in this instance because the texts partly came from the Clark Art Institute in English. I wrote texts in English. Some texts were written in German, and it all had to be welded together.
And how much do the texts and the context change when you move from the United States to Germany and then to Norway?
That changes a lot, because each museum has its own house, rules, and style, its habits. Here the texts are shorter than they were in America, because they don't want them exceeding a certain word count. And the Norwegians will have both sets of texts to work with. They will probably combine them in some way or introduce their own elements.
And for Register Matthias, what remaining tasks are on his mind?
We will be doing the installation news. This is the one before
2. The first peak comes in West Lapland, featuring guests from Norway.
On behalf of the museum, I'm exceptionally proud to see present here today.
In the audience is Knoebels Amusement, the curator from the Monk Museum, where the show is heading after its run at the Bonomini. As a monk specialist, what are her first impressions walking through the exhibition?
I love this work so done with ours, the materials. Always love to see how works from the collections mixed together with our works.
Upstairs in the room with the beach scenes, the Petersburg hanging and the turquoise walls.
We realized through colors, it was always nice to have colors on the wall when we have works to pay for too, I think.
Among them is a special work, Young Woman on the Beach, a vividly colored print.
It's a vividly colored print that exists so many different places for us. We actually think that the world is a beautiful place and it's not true, so we can't be true of it. But I think that's the beginning of the work. That's a fun
thing. In the walk of people, it's turned right onto West Market Street.
Achieving our goals in any